We have the unique pleasure of having with us three general counsels of the three of the four major leagues. It's ironic that the day happens to be the NHL's trading deadline. And although we have friends at the NHL, we were told that all lawyers at the NHL were on 24/7 duty today. So we can't bring you the voice of hockey. Now, that's Rick Buchanan. He's NBA. This is Tom Ostertag. He's Major League Baseball. And this is Jeff Pasch, NHL. No, NFL. He's damn
NHL at one time.
That's right. You were with Bettman for 4 years. You've had this curious career.
Right. Can't hold a job.
Now, these are very talented people. All three of them went to first-class law schools, which shall remain nameless. Two of them were associates, and Jeff was a partner at Covington and Burling. Tom was in Sidley Austin.
A predecessor firm to it.
Yeah.
But yes.
Okay. Now, Rick, you were at CNB, right?
Yes.
And what was it, about 1984 that you made a transition?
No, 93. So I came out of law school in 88. I was a clerk for a year.
With?
With Judge Ken Starr.
Yes, you people forget that he was a judge. He was a judge on the D.C. Circuit.
Before he became notorious, he was an excellent judge.
Before he became notorious, huh? Go ahead.
And then I went to work at Covington and Burling. I was a summer associate there between my third year of law school and my clerkship. I managed to wrangle a couple of sports assignments from a very charitable partner by the name of Jeff Pasch, who took pity on me and gave me a couple of chances. And then after law school, I was fortunate to get an offer from the firm, and I said I will come, but I would very much like to do sports work. And so I was assigned to work with Paul Tagliabue and Jeff Pasch. And the firm had a nice arrangement at that time. When you came in as a first-year lawyer, they gave you two assignments. You get one with one partner and one with another. So they said, okay, well, Buchanan, you can have this sports practice, and we'll do practice to be named later. And I showed up, and they said, and your other practice is tobacco litigation. So that's the high and the low of working at Covington and Burling. And then after that, I was there for about 4.5 years. Took a job with the NBA in 1993, have been there ever since. I'm now general counsel of the league, also our chief compliance officer as we begin to become a more global company and have to worry about Foreign Corrupt Practices Act and things of that nature.
So you've been there 21 years?
Yes.
I mean, is this addiction for sports? Was that prenatal, or when were you struck by it?
Yes, I think, I guess it was. I mean, I played every sport that there is. I still am, if I'm not working or doing things with my family, I'm probably playing some kind of sport. And I guess my logic was, and what I tell people is that in an ideal world, you would work doing something where you're interested in it anyway. I'm one of the kind of people that, for better or for worse, when the newspaper comes, I'm going to pick up the sports section first. And so it happens to marry up to what I'm doing professionally.
It's funny. Some people pick up the sports section first. I pick it up last. But then I eat the icing off cake last, too. So it's a similar phenomenon. Now, Tom, you're out of Virginia.
Yeah.
The law school.
The law school, right.
And how did you move from law practice to the league?
Well, I actually, it really starts at Virginia. When I was a first-year student there, I remember thinking to myself, I should start thinking about next summer and what I'm going to do, you know, for the summer. And that was, I guess, the fall of my first year. And I decided, well, let's start at the top. Where would I most like to work? And I thought of the baseball commissioner's office.
Naturally.
I didn't know anything about it. I barely knew where it was. I certainly didn't know anybody there. I knew the name of the commissioner, Bowie Kuhn, and I wrote him a cold letter. I got a nice letter back saying, probably not, but if you're in New York over the holidays, feel free to stop in. We'd like to talk to you. Of course, I was in New York over the holidays and did, and I still got the answer, probably not, but they were thinking of hiring one intern that summer, and it turned out that they did, and it was me. So I was there that summer after my first year of law school, and worked very hard, had a lot of fun, never thought I'd go back. Finished law school, went to Brown and Wood, which merged into Sidley. And I was a fourth-year associate there when the commissioner changed. Bowie Kuhn left and Peter Ueberroth arrived. And the general counsel for Bowie Kuhn decided to retire. The fellow beneath him moved up. There was a spot underneath, and they thought of me, and I thought of them, and I went back in early 1985, and I've been there since. It's been quite a ride. If you count this internship and working for Bowie Kuhn, I've worked for five different commissioners, and there have been only nine in history of baseball, so in that time I've worked for more than half of them. It's amazing. And if you want to count the period when our executive council had the powers of the commissioner, which were about 6 years worth, from 92 to 98. That you count that as something separate. For the first 6 or 7 years there, I probably did almost as much MLB properties work as I did commissioner's office work. I was doing virtually everything that came down the pike. That became very voluminous, and in the early 90s we had a general counsel for properties, and I continued as general counsel in the commissioner's office. But it's been a very interesting ride.
And you've been there now 29 years.
I guess that's right, yeah.
Give or take one or two.
Yeah. No, it's been since February of 85, so I guess that's right.
You think you have job security?
There are no rules, Art. There are no rules.
Yeah, I guess those of us who hang out here, we have tenure, whatever that means. Now, Jeff, you were the only one of the three up here to have the misfortune of being in my procedure class. And that was around 1980, wasn't it?
It's a little bit before then, but I'll take it.
And your progression?
See,
there are a lot of wannabes out there.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if this will be helpful or not. I've said to people when asked how I got where I am that it was pure dumb luck. I really, really didn't have very much to do with it. I went to work at Covington & Burling. I did not know that Covington & Burling had represented the National Football League for decades. Didn't know any of the lawyers who were involved in the sports practice at Covington & Burling. And unlike Rick, when I went there and was asked, what would I like to do, I didn't say sports. I think I said my father practiced medicine for many years, so I knew they had a food and drug law practice. I said, well, that might be kind of interesting. And I showed up, and I found myself assigned to a great NYU alum named Paul Tagliabue. Took me a week or so to figure out how to pronounce his name. And I found out that I was working for the NFL. And that's pretty much how it happened. I started first case that I was assigned to was a hotly contested dispute where the former owner of the then Oakland, and now Oakland Raiders, a man named Al Davis, wanted to move the team from Oakland to Los Angeles. and the other owners in the league and Commissioner Rozelle were opposed to it, so I started working on that. And one thing led to another. We had a number of labor issues. We had litigation from another league called the U.S. Football League that was tried here in New York in front of Judge Peter Leisure, who just recently passed away, I believe. And I continued doing it. And Paul succeeded Pete Rozelle as the commissioner of the NFL in 1989. And so I kept doing that until I went to work at the Hockey League.
Yeah. Now, what caused you to make that transition? What motivated you?
Well, I thought it would be sort of interesting to make the mess instead of being necessarily the person who got called to clean up the mess. And I just thought it would be interesting to. I'd worked closely with the general counsel at the NFL during my years at Covington. I knew the new hockey commissioner, Gary Bettman, because he had been the general counsel at the basketball league before he went to the hockey league. And it was obvious to me that he really wanted to re-energize that sport. Even though I grew up in a farm town in California, my father is Canadian. And so I was probably the only kid in Fresno, California who knew anything about hockey. So I was always kind of interested in the sport. And I thought it would just be a fun opportunity, and it turned out to be exactly that.
Then you make a transition, what, about 4 years later?
About 4 years later, my predecessor as a general counsel at the Football League retired, and then Commissioner Tagliabue asked me if I would like to take that role. So
putting the two together, you've got about 21 years with leagues.
I do.
And putting the three of you together, you got close to 70 years with leagues. None of you really look 70, but that's what we've got. No, I'm just a sports fan. I've been a sports fan since I was five. Like most New Yorkers, I wanted to play center field for the New York Yankees. One of the fortunately few failures in my life.
Still time.
Well, yeah, don't give up.
Still time.
You mean if Ellsbury gets hurt, I can go in?
That's a certainty.
I have faith in
you. Now, one thing that struck me, and it's been striking me harder and harder since I got involved with the Sports and Society program here at NYU, is that sports, number one, it has moved from the back pages to the front pages. If you watch the 11 o'clock news, there are more seconds devoted to sports coverage than 20 years ago. And I have a sense of turbulence in the sports industry. If you look back 3 or 4 years, what do you see? You see antitrust. You see labor lockouts. You see a lot of intellectual property stuff. You see a lot of conduct, human conduct, that gets caught up in things. You even see bankruptcies of some teams, not NFL teams. You see the LA Dodgers end up in the divorce court. My friend, our friend, Fred Wilpon, gets caught up with Madoff. Is there more turbulence in sports these days? Rick?
I don't think so. I think it's always been turbulent. I don't know. I'm not sure why it is, but I agree with your premise that there is a fair amount of focus on what the leagues do and on especially the conduct part that you mentioned. I find basic questions of how people relate to each other, it seems to me, oftentimes get played out through the prism of sports. Can't really tell you why, but I just know it's true. And so my anecdote for that is 1998, we had a situation involving Latrell Sprewell and TJ Carlissimo, where one of the player choked his coach during a practice. And this was not 11 o'clock news, this was national news, this was on everybody's mind, and the entire topic of sort of workplace relations, racial issues that were part of that, the sort of that entire issue got played out. So about 3 days after the incident occurred, there was a press conference in San Francisco, and at that time, television wasn't quite what it was, but so it was being carried locally on some stations, but we had a special camera there so that we could get a satellite feed of this press conference. So I'm sitting in the commissioner's office watching this special feed we have to see Latrell Sprewell and his attorney and players stand up and say whatever they had to say. So this is happening at about 5:30 in the afternoon.
So I'm sitting in the office, we're watching this, it lasts about 25 minutes, the feed closes, the television clicks over to whatever channel was behind it, which was ABC or something, and we're starting to discuss what we saw with the volume off. And I'm looking over Commissioner Stern's shoulder at the television, and Peter Jennings comes on, and it's the national news. And the first story on the national news is Latrell Sprewell chokes his coach and the developments and whatever, and it's going on for 4 minutes or so. And that, okay, fine, that's fine. The second story is inspectors find evidence of atomic weapons in Iraq. The second story. And I'm watching that and my jaw hits the table. And so it's just, I'm not sure what it is, but there's a fascination and there's a way in which people play out some of these kind of basic issues through the prism of sports, and it continues to happen, and at least in my time at the NBA, it really has never not been so.
Mm. Well, look at right now. You know, everyone in this room understands how hapless the Knicks are. Why do they show up?
I have no comments.
No comments. Well, what is getting as much attention as the latest Knick loss? It's Felton. It's that same fascination, the same fascination. You have an explanation for it? Because surely Major League Baseball manages to get on the front page every once in a while.
Oh, we do. I think I'm with Rick, though, in saying that probably not quite as turbulent these days as it has been in the past. When I think about our most turbulent times, I think the mid-1990s were the worst, at least in my years. And that was the time when we had a long player strike starting in August of 94 that extended through the postseason, which was eliminated. And until about the third week of April, we started the 1995 season late. And it was a terrible time. We were in Washington testifying frequently during those years. I mentioned that the executive council in baseball officially had the commissioner's powers, although Bud Selig was running the sport for sure. He didn't have the title of commissioner during those years. Fay Vinson had stepped down in the fall of 92, and things were reexamined in baseball during those years. And we had lots of lawsuits. We had lots of days when we were on the front pages. And for all those reasons, and probably some I'm forgetting, I think those were our most turbulent times.
But those were, you know, the strikes. That's labor stuff. As you sit here right now, aren't you deeply embarrassed by A-Rod?
I'll incorporate by comment Rick's comments about the Knicks.
I instruct my client not to answer that question.
That's right.
Well, in a sense, I can understand the reaction. That's not, the ink is not dry on that story. But to have, you know, to step back a year or so and see your MVP, Braun, I mean, that too is on the front page or the evening news.
You can take that as a comment if you want, but it won't be verbal.
Okay.
Let me just say on behalf of my client that I am impressed by the breadth and depth of baseball's investigation, which led to all the suspensions of the players. You'd note that none of the 13 players that were recently suspended by baseball were suspended as a result of adverse tests. They were suspended as a result of investigation that baseball did, which takes a ton of work and a ton of effort, and it shows baseball's commitment to getting their drug program right.
Yeah, and that, without any question, is a plus, no doubt. It also illustrates something you said, Rick, that a lot of the issues that we see today are workplace-type issues, and they're relational issues in terms of player and team and league, et cetera, et cetera. Now, you've had a good year, haven't you?
We're just a sleepy little sport, trying to stay under the radar screen and, you know, provide a little entertainment.
You just check in with the cash register every week.
Right, right. Not exactly.
Did you think the so-called bullying was going to explode the way it did explode in terms of the media?
Of course. Of course. Look, I think you've got a couple of things going on that result in the phenomena that you observed and started this discussion with. One is most everybody has played sports in some form or another, and so they naturally think that they most people do understand sports. They understand basketball. They understand baseball. They understand the relationship between a player and a coach, and most of us sit there in some form or another, as you jokingly said, you know, I could do that. You know, I could do that. I did that. You know, maybe not quite as well, but I did that too. And by contrast, when people talk about the London Whale, or they talk about credit default swaps, but most of us, I certainly put myself in this category, don't have the foggiest idea what the London Whale did or didn't do. I couldn't tell you why he cost all this money to J.P. Morgan. I couldn't tell you, you know, when people say, well, Blythe Masters invented the credit default swap, I'm like, gosh, wonder what that is, you know? Good job, you know? Don't know what that means. And so things with tremendous consequences for our economy and our society can happen, but we don't really understand what it meant. But when a player attacks a coach, well, we've all been on a playground and we've all been with a coach. We understand that. And when one player bullies another and leaves him voicemails that are shockingly obscene and racist, well, we understand that. So that's one thing. We're dealing with an area that all of us have some experience with and feel that we can identify with, at least to some extent. The second thing is that in contrast to the 50s, 60s, 70s, there is tremendous competition amongst media outlets, whether it's the TMZs, the Deadspins, ESPN and all 19 of its networks, or even conventional print media. There's tremendous competition, and so things that would have been under the radar screen in politics, in business, or in sports are now impossible to keep quiet and are exposed and publicized and talked about and tweeted and everything else. So I think you've got a combination of factors that results in things moving from page 25 to page 1.
It's really astounding, this last point you made. I grew up in the era of Williams and DiMaggio, and you never heard, read anything about their private lives. As far as I could tell, because he became my hero, particularly when he married Marilyn Monroe, which was before he married Arthur Miller. But that's another story. Joe DiMaggio was the hero. And it was years and years after he passed that the writing turned to he was a son of a bitch. But today, every player is in the limelight. Every player. The only one, of course, they write about it all the time, to have escaped it really is Jeter, who has led a rather charmed life. So the media is so powerful. The media is so ubiquitous. It moves you.
And I guess an obvious point what people have commented on, I mean, it may turn out to be different in the future, but at least up to the present, there's several sections in the newspaper, one of which is solely devoted to sports. I mean, the entertainment industry, the movie industry, those are industries that people are very interested in, but they don't have their own section in the newspaper for, I mean, in some newspapers they do, but not in most. And for traditional reasons, whatever it is, it's just a little odd that one industry has this one area. So as Jeff said, one of the things that's a little bit unique about working in our offices, and I'm sure it's this case for all three of us, is there's this notion virtually every day you're in a situation that may require what at least we call in our office rapid response. We had a guy who worked for us for a while who came from the White House, and he said that's basically the only other position he's aware of that's like that. Every day there's going to be something that requires us immediately to be on it from a policy, rules, business point of view, and to be dealing with a media interpretation of it. And in this current 24-hour, 12-hour news cycle, I mean, you've got to get on it immediately or it's going to turn into something that you may not want.
Now let's talk about litigation. All three leagues get involved in litigation. Probably the most prominent case, and I realize it's still sub judice, is the concussion case. And we're dealing with, in your sport, concussions, the retirees being so concerned about their health long term. All of you have labor management issues, and all of you have, except you, Tom, you don't have an antitrust problem, do you?
It's not a business, it's a sport.
You talk
that's
about
the Supreme Court said so.
That's
you talk
no, it
about
did not
an
say
industry
exactly
having
no.
its own section of the paper. This guy has his own constitution.
Pretty great.
That's a bit of an exaggeration.
Really?
A bit.
You're going to defend the baseball exemption?
Well,
or you don't.
I'm more than happy to defend our exemption, and I'd be happy to see the other sports have one too, as a matter of fact. I know that the Supreme Court felt differently with the American Needle decision, but mm-hmm. I view ourselves as...
Tell them about American Needle. Not all of them have had exposure to that case.
Well, it was a football case. I don't want to... Yeah. Jeff well, might be in
should
much
I have
better position.
Jeff, my old student, state the case? No, that would be cruel. In a nutshell, American Needle.
The Broncos did better than we did. Let's just put it that way.
In one sentence, the Supreme Court decided that the NFL was not a single entity. And that the teams, at least for some purposes, compete one against the other. You know, I don't fully agree with that decision, as you might guess, and I think it's pretty clear that sports compete with all forms of entertainment. We compete among ourselves up here. Certainly baseball and football and basketball and hockey compete, but we also compete with all forms of entertainment. And these days, as the world is getting more complicated and the tech boom just keeps developing and developing, we compete with, you know, somebody using a handheld device who's, you know, not watching one of our games. We compete with any kind of pastime you can name. We compete with somebody, you know, it's funny, I used to say when I spoke, we compete with somebody who's walking down the beach, taking a walk on the beach, because somebody's walking on the beach is not sitting in a ballpark and is not watching a game on TV. It's a leisure activity that doesn't involve watching one of our games.
This is now the most ridiculous definition of competition, Tom.
Well, I'm not quite done.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm not quite done, and you won't think so when I'm finished. Now that person walking down the beach probably has a handheld and might be watching something and might be watching a sport other than baseball or might be watching some other form of entertainment. The competition has multiplied, multiplied, and multiplied again. And we believe as a result that, you know, if you're marketing Major League Baseball or the National Basketball Association or the National Football League, you know, you can do that as a product because everything else out there is also a product and you're competing against them. And I think that's the better way to look at things. I haven't talked to Jeff and Rick about this, but I would trust that they feel similarly.
Well, I don't teach antitrust. I can spell it, but that's about it. It seems to me you've just written a good portion of the antitrust statute out. See, the issue in American Needle was whether the joint action of the teams, you correct me if I'm wrong, the joint action of the teams in awarding a contract for, what was it, hats?
Yes.
Hats. Whether that was a conspiracy.
Right.
And the leagues, and you just heard Tom, argued that the league was a single entity and a single entity can't conspire with itself. And you took that all the way to the Supreme Court. You won in the district. You won in the Seventh Circuit.
Right.
But you died ignominiously in the Supreme Court. It was 9-0.
As I say, Denver got more points than we did.
Now, was that a serious loss? I mean, you've had a tremendous litigation record. You've done so well. Delaware betting, the Brady case, the Maurice Claret, you preserved the eligibility. I mean, remarkable litigation experience. This is the one dark mark.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's, you know, look, I said to the owners, we had the good fortune to have an owners meeting the day that decision came out, you know. So we had the, you know, we had like about 3 minutes to figure out how we would explain it. And
spin it?
No, I said, no. I said,
devil
look,
got my tongue.
No, that's cool. I said, someone said you were a gentle interlocutor, but I said, I know better. I said to the owners that morning that there's no possible way to spin a loss in the Supreme Court, frankly, whether it's 9-0 or 5-4. I mean, it doesn't matter if you were the NFL losing 9-0 or Al Gore losing 5-4. You've lost and it's done and over with and you have to go on. I don't think it's and it's obviously a serious loss on that legal issue. We can't relitigate that issue. In terms of the effect on our business, I think it has no meaningful effect at all because it has been, and I think this does not write any kind of new chapter in the antitrust laws, this is pretty black letter law, that competitive bidding for an exclusive license is a well-recognized business practice. It has been upheld in many contexts. The Justice Department has opined as far back as the 60s, at least, maybe earlier than that, but as far back as the 60s, that it's a legitimate business practice and pro-competitive because it encourages the winner to make investments in product quality, in marketing, in outreach to consumers, in improvements and innovation over time that end up generating the kinds of benefits for consumers that the antitrust laws are intended to promote. So we are very confident as to how that litigation ultimately will come out. And as I say, it has not affected our business practices in this respect.
Yeah. Just to drop a footnote on what Jeff just said, that case is still alive.
Yes.
It is still alive.
Yeah.
Because the only thing the Supreme Court decided
was
the single entity.
It didn't address market definition. It didn't address impact on competition. None of those core antitrust issues were addressed in the matter that was heard by the court.
Rick, what are you experiencing in the litigation? What kinds of cases either bother you, trouble you, bug you?
Well, I'm sorry you asked me, just because I can't give a very interesting answer. Jeff and I were talking on the ride down. For reasons that I can't explain, the NBA has been fortunate in the last decade or so to have not caught what prior to then was a fairly consistent stream of serious antitrust or commercial litigations. And I look across at sister leagues and they are involved in these kinds of cases, and we haven't been. So my litigation docket is fairly, it's standard fare for any business. I have workplace cases, employment related cases, intellectual property disputes. Something that has been troubling us recently, this is again not particularly unique to sports, but is patent cases. We have trolls coming out in serious numbers in the last 5-6 years, deciding that virtually everything that you can do on the internet is owned by someone. So the technology that allows you to click on that link and it turns into a photograph, oh, okay, this plaintiff claims to own it. And because we have a website that people know about, beyond the 4 million other websites that apparently they don't, we get sued along with, you know, the other sports leagues and some television networks and entertainment companies. So we've been battling in that realm a bit of late. But in terms of the sort of bigger bet the company kind of foundational principle cases, we haven't seen as many of those in a while. And I will only comment on American Needle to say that in the 90s, we had a case involving the Chicago Bulls and their television rights, where we won in the Seventh Circuit from Judge Easterbrook a decision that said that the NBA may well be a single entity in for purposes of selling its television rights. And then American Needle followed on. The NFL got good decisions in the Seventh Circuit and then went up to the Supreme Court and lost. In the NBA, we call that a failure to finish. So that we sort of passed the ball, and then apparently they just missed the layup at the end. Missed it 9-0, so it was just swatted out into the crowd somewhere. But that's...
We finished all right.
Intellectual property, you mentioned it. You do get cases in that field. You know, you were involved in that Motorola case.
Yes.
So
Motorola was, that's an interesting case. This shows you, I'm a litigator originally, worked with Jeff as a litigator. That's my background, but it's interesting when you're on the inside to see how oftentimes business practices pass by the dispute that you happen to be involved with. So Motorola was a case in the early part of the 2000s or late 90s where they were producing a pager product that allowed the user to receive updates on NBA games in progress. So they had individuals sitting in our arenas or watching on television, typing the data into a data stream that would provide points, rebounds, other stats about the game. And if you had a Motorola SportsTrax pager, you could take it and read it and follow the game in progress. And we said, well, that's competing with our games that we're showing on television and essentially misappropriating our data. And so we brought a lawsuit to stop them from doing that, winning in the district court and then losing in the Second Circuit on copyright preemption grounds. But by the time we lost in the Second Circuit, we had received an injunction in the district court, and the technology had passed Motorola by, and they had stopped making pagers a year before the Second Circuit issued the decision. So as a matter of business, it became a sort of non-event. But it was a very interesting case about who owns data, and since sports are a big part of it, is the statistics and information about the games, for how long you own it, and this hot news doctrine in coming down from the Supreme Court. So intellectually, it's a very interesting case.
It's a fascinating case because it shows you the impact of new technology against ancient doctrine in the copyright field and the incredible magnification of product. You know, I'm, again, old school. I look at a box score. I'm happy with the box score. To me, nothing will ever replace the batting average. This guy sitting right here, I mean, he's a nut. He does all this analytics stuff, producing more and more and more data, some of which may be or may not be copyrightable. And the delivery systems proliferate. I've got a bone to pick with you. Why is it every day I come in and I turn on my computer and there's some goddamn thing from MLB? Why am I getting all that stuff? How did you find me? I'm an anonymous guy. I keep lead a quiet life. I don't bother anybody, and this stuff just keeps coming in.
Did you put cameras in his house, too?
We're marketing as Major League Baseball. I assume that comes from our website, and they've done just a fantastic job. Well, I am speaking seriously and more generally. It's... You know, I don't take any credit for it at all. They are a separate entity and, in fact, located in Chelsea, apart from our offices.
My God, that's around the corner from me.
Well, maybe that's how they found you. Saw you on the street. But you must have either signed up for something, you must have purchased something. I don't know.
I went to Yankee Stadium once.
Give you a more complete answer. Did you buy tickets online?
No, I didn't buy tickets. I mean, it's a semi-serious question, because to my knowledge, I've had no contact with MLB. So they got me somewhere.
You should have had.
I should have had.
We want to get you more contact with MLB. I'm trying to think how it could be. No products?
No, I once bought something at the stadium. I think it was a hot dog.
That's all it takes. You're now in the system.
It's in that stuff they call beef, but we know isn't. No, I'm fascinated by it because it's modern marketing, isn't it?
Sure. Absolutely.
It's know your customer base.
Absolutely.
And that becomes a tremendously valuable product for all of the leagues. Why is it I don't get anything from you guys? I'm a good football fan.
Well, we'll get you signed up, Professor. Don't you worry. It's the off season, but you'll hear from us.
I see. You're trying to get even from procedure, huh? There's a case in the Supreme Court. ABC versus Aero. All three of you, I believe, have filed amicus briefs.
Two of us.
Two of us? You haven't.
No. Jeff, the NFL and baseball have. We filed it two nights ago, in fact. Right.
But Rick hasn't?
Not yet.
Not yet. You want to tell them what that case is? It's in the Supreme Court. Cert has been granted.
Cert has been granted.
It's going to be argued soon.
Yes.
It's fascinating.
At bottom, it's a copyright infringement case. And I was interested in a comment that one of my classmates and your former student, Jane Ginsburg.
Oh, Jane, yes.
Made on this point.
Ruth Jane, Ginsburg's daughter.
She said that when the Court of Appeals opinion came out upholding this practice, which we are all against, she thought it was so contrary to the plain language of the copyright statute that it was written as an April Fool's joke. A statement that the broadcasters, I believe, have quoted no fewer than four or five times in their brief, just to make sure that Justice Ginsburg and her clerks focus on that point.
They're assuming a good relationship between mother
they
and
are.
Daughter.
They are assuming a good relationship between mother and daughter. It's also true. The attorney who wrote the brief for baseball and the NFL told me this yesterday. I did not know it. I called him just to congratulate him, thank him for a good... The Justice Department has also come in on the side of the broadcasters and the sports leagues. It basically has to do with a practice, and because it's a rather sophisticated technology, I'm quite certain I will mangle it. But it is a way of obtaining broadcast signals or cable television transmissions sort of over the top of the existing broadcast and cable models. So it allows a consumer to get this service called Aereo, which circumvents the existing local broadcast models and the existing cable subscription models. And it thereby, in the views of the broadcasters, threatens the viability of the broadcast model, sharply undermines their ability to generate retransmission fees and audiences that they need to support the investments that they make in programming. And needless to say, those of us like the NFL who rely heavily on broadcast television as a means of reaching our fans and generating audiences that at times can approach 150 or 160 million viewers in this country, we rely heavily on that model, and we don't want to see it compromised or undermined in any way, and we certainly don't want to be in a position where our product is being used to undercut that model, and it's being done, frankly, with no compensation and no permission to do so. And the technology is much more complicated. I'm not doing it justice. I'm sure whoever came up with it deserves some plaudits. But Tom, you want to comment?
Well, I could add one fact about the technology that might help you picture it. Aereo has thousands and thousands of tiny antennas, dime-sized antennas. Instead of having one big antenna that retransmits signals out to everybody, they do it with individual antennas. And so what they are trying to say, you know, through this technology is that they are not engaging in a public performance. They're engaging in thousands and thousands of private performances. And they're trying to analogize their technology to just a television or anything else that retransmits a single signal, which is not a public performance under the Copyright Act. The problem is, as you might have already concluded, if you're taking a signal and doing thousands of retransmissions, and they're all of the same signal at the same time, that's not a public performance. There are, you know, some judges who, one judge, Judge Chin here in New York, who is on the Second Circuit and dissented from the panel opinion, called it a Rube Goldberg contrivance. There's a judge in Utah who recently issued an injunction against Aereo. There's a second company called Film On X that was enjoined in DC. There are other decisions that have gone in favor of these companies. So it's, you know, some of one, some of the other. And the court, despite the procedural posture of this case, which is fairly preliminary, these are only preliminary injunctions at this point, the court decided to take it. And I think it was a very good thing that it did, so we get an answer to this. But under the Copyright Act, if you're engaging in a public performance, you need consent of the copyright owner. And to boil this down to its very basics, you know, Jeff, I know Rick and NHL also believe, broadcasters believe, the Solicitor General believes that these constitute public performances. And there is a lot involved because, Jeff talked about the various fees that are paid. That's a more complicated subject, but there is an awful lot involved here.
Yes. And the issue is, I used to teach copyright, but I haven't taught it for, a decade now. And Tom's right. The question, loosely speaking, is whether what Aereo does on a collective basis with these thousands of individualized antennas is a public performance. There is also a provision in the Copyright Act that exempts receipt on a household mechanism. And it's strange, if you hang around long enough, almost everything you saw as a kid comes back to see and bother you in old age. When I was in practice, in 1961, a lot of years ago. The last case I worked on was the case involving the community antenna television industry, which preceded cable. When if you lived in Clarksville, West Virginia, and because of the mountains, you could not get a TV signal, someone stuck an antenna on the top of the mountain and fed the signal through wires to individual homes so that they could receive the signal.
This is
fortnightly. I'm glad you remembered the name of the case. That was the last case I worked on in practice. And as you undoubtedly recall, the court couldn't deal with it. It basically said this requires a legislative solution. And here it is again in a, admittedly, a different form, but it's sort of the same case.
Fortnightly was using the 1909 Copyright Act.
Right. Which there are those who love it.
Which predated cable, it predated television, it even predated radio. It was wholly unsuitable, you know, to be applied to this kind of technology. If Fortnightly were still good law, I think ARIA would have a much, much stronger case. But Fortnightly was legislatively overruled by the 1976 Copyright Act.
Replaced, not overruled.
Okay, I said legislatively.
Yes. No, Tom's right. It's a different world. But just from a sociological point of view, because I was involved in the enactment of the 76-78 Copyright Act, by the time you finish writing the statute, it's obsolete. It's obsolete. The technologies have moved past the statute.
There's talk these days of Congress getting together and trying to enact a new Copyright Act.
It's going to take
years and years and years of work.
That's a joke.
Well, you know, they did it in the 70s, and it took them 15 to 20 years.
That's the point.
It may take that long, but maybe, you know, in 15 or 20 years, we'll get the benefit of it. Who knows?
In 15 or 20 years, some of us will be dead. But that has nothing to do with the discussion. Let's talk about labor relations for a little bit. There's been a lot of activity in that. The three of you are experiencing sort of labor peace at the moment, aren't you?
Yes. There are things that, by their very nature, management and labor will disagree on, but our relations are, I think, pretty good.
So we've got a period of stability. Does that apply to you, or do you?
Yes. So the collective bargaining agreements in professional sports run for some number of years, and during the period when they are expired, there is inevitably some amount of controversy and difficulty in trying to come to a new contract. Once that contract is concluded, on a relative basis, things are more peaceful and the business can go forward. And so that's where we are. We were in the same time frame as the NFL for our last labor contract, 2011. Unfortunately, we were not completely harmonious in our negotiations. We had a lockout that lasted some number of months and eventually concluded an agreement, though. So we're now in the third season of that. It's an agreement that essentially splits all the revenue that comes into the NBA 50-50 between the owners and the players, and things seem to be going well.
You've had your labor problems, but even baseball is in a peaceful condition.
A very, very nice, peaceful era right now. And I'll start out by saying I don't do any labor work in our office. We have a separate labor group, and they get all the credit for it. But, you know, we're up to close to 20 years, and we'll be beyond 20 through 16, which is our current contract. And it's such a nice switch from, I described the mid-90s earlier. That was, maybe the bottom. And this is tremendous compared to that. Mm.
But you had your fight just a few years ago.
2011.
When was there a union? Wasn't there a union? But again, you did rather well in the Brady case.
Well, the Brady case, just so give people 30 seconds of background, we were bargaining with our union, and they opted to break off the bargaining, which was going on at the Federal Mediation Service in Washington under the supervision of the head of the FMCS. They opted to break off, and they did what they called a disclaimer of interest. They said, we don't want to be a union anymore. We don't want to engage in collective bargaining. We disclaim any role as a collective bargaining representative. And their contention was that would free them to file litigation to keep us from exercising what we thought were our labor law rights to lock out the players and not allow them to come to work until they had agreed to a new contract. So they filed this lawsuit. It was called the Brady case because the lead plaintiff was Tom Brady of the New England Patriots. They filed it in the District of Minnesota, which has been their chosen forum for litigation for now probably close to 40 years, going back to when Joe Capp, the Vikings quarterback, filed the first case there. And the district judge, in a very long scholarly opinion, granted an injunction and said, you can't lock the players out. So under the rules of procedure, the first thing, I do remember this much, the first thing you have to do is you have to ask the district judge for a stay of the injunction, which we did. The district judge said, no, I'm not going to stay my injunction, which was predictable. So we then asked the Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals for an emergency stay on the basis of a rather old statute called the Norris-LaGuardia Act, as in LaGuardia Airport. And the Norris-LaGuardia Act says to the federal courts, you have no jurisdiction, you have no authority to enter an injunction in a labor dispute. Well, this was very clearly a labor dispute, but the issue that the players raised was it can't be a labor dispute unless there is a labor union. And in fact, the Supreme Court had settled that question sometime earlier, quite a few decades ago, in a case where they said it doesn't have to be a labor union. Any group of employees or group of employers can be engaged in a labor dispute. The technical existence or non-existence of a labor union is of no consequence. So we asked the Court of Appeals for an emergency stay. The judge had entered her order on a Monday. She had denied our request for a stay, the district judge, on Wednesday. So Friday, as Commissioner Goodell was about to open day two of the draft at Radio City Music Hall, we got word that the Eighth Circuit had granted the stay. That had a profound and positive effect on the commissioner's mood, not to mention the mood of our owners. Then they proceeded to consider the stay on a more robust basis, and they confirmed that, and then they ultimately reversed the injunction. But it's a little bit like what Rick was saying about the Motorola case. By the time they reversed the injunction, which I would say was the second week of July, we were so close to having agreed on a new contract that it was almost like we wished they hadn't done it, you know, because we did not need anyone to throw sand in the gears at that point, including, respectfully, the Eighth Circuit. But they reversed the injunction, upheld the viability of the Norris-LaGuardia Act. So it was like a
case on speed. It just kept moving and moving. I remember Bob Bolin, who's standing back there, and I was supposed to be teaching sports law this year, wondering what the hell do we teach?
Yeah, no, it did move quickly. But in the cases involving preliminary injunctions, I guess that's not all that unusual.
But this issue, Arthur, that Jeff is describing is one that has been in play in the sports industry now for years, which is the so-called labor exemption from the antitrust laws, which is the question of when you're in collective bargaining with a union in a circumstance where the employer is a multi-employer bargaining unit, that is to say, in professional sports, a bunch of independent teams. okay, is that when those independent teams agree on conduct like a lockout of employees or even bargaining proposals, we're all going to agree that we're going to propose this wage scale. Is that some kind of potential horizontal conspiracy under the antitrust laws? And obviously, I'm completely biased on this, but this is just nuts. I mean, it's beyond sort of arguing the merits of it. Just if you look at the instability that's introduced by this, if it would just be nice to know what the rules are. If the rules are, you are playing in an arena of labor law, and both sides have rights and remedies. Both sides have tools. They can strike. We can lock out. We can put various proposals on the table. There are tactics you can engage in that are permissible under the NLRA. The National Labor Relations Board will entertain unfair labor practice charges. We all understand what that arena is. If that's what it is, then we will go at it. But if there's this other thing sitting out there, which is either antitrust litigation or the threat of antitrust litigation, and some judge who comes in who's applying some entirely different standard that's not any of this, it injects all of this instability and then changes the behavior of the parties at the table. And so what you see is, in Jeff's case, you see the lawyer and the representing their union and their union officials holding back, not making proposals, not moving the negotiations forward because they think they have this weapon. And we thought in 1995, in another Supreme Court case, Brown versus Pro Football, that I worked on when I was at Covington, and Jeff did as well when it was in the lower courts, we thought we had it resolved. The Supreme Court actually gave an opinion on the labor exemption, but not quite. They left the door open at the back end for conduct like what the NFL Players Union engaged in. And ours did too in our negotiation, only it lasted for 2 days. They just claimed interest for 2 days, and then we sort of made a deal. And that we never got into court, but I know which answer I'd like, but almost equally as much, I just like one answer, so that we could conduct ourselves in a sort of intelligent way, and we wouldn't have. I think it would be beneficial to the fans because I just think that agreements would be made in a more expeditious way, and we'd have less disruption to the games.
Yeah. You also have a state of affairs where it is impossible to really know what you should do. So for example, when a collective bargaining agreement expires, an employer is obligated under the labor laws. The labor laws require you to adhere to the terms of that expired collective bargaining agreement. So a collective bargaining agreement expires and it calls for whatever benefits the labor has and whatever obligations they have, and the employer adheres to that. In sports, the players say, we're not a labor union anymore, and so if you do what the labor laws require you to do, you're violating the federal antitrust laws. That's a hard one to really kind of work your way through. If you fail to discharge your obligations under the labor laws, you might avoid antitrust liability, but you'd have liability in another context. If you stick to your obligations under the labor laws, well, then they say you're liable for treble damages or injunctive relief. So it is a very, as Rick says, it would be nice to have a clear answer. I'm where Rick is. Tom doesn't have this problem, but good guess he's in the same place. But if you have mature labor management relations with a strong union, and there are no unions in this country who are stronger than the professional sports unions. There are no unions in this country who are stronger, better funded, better advised, more capable of engaging in collective bargaining and collective action. I mean, a player strike cost baseball the World Series. Player strikes have cost full seasons, or come close to costing full seasons. Lockouts have cost full seasons. Tremendous economic consequences for both sides. So this is not a case where we should abandon collective bargaining as a solution. It is an area where collective bargaining is really much, much the most ideal solution.
And it gives you a certain advantage because you can put things in the collective bargaining agreement and take them off the litigation table.
Well, not just, we can do that, that's quite right, but that's precisely what collective bargaining is intended to do, is get stuff out of litigation and into a mature and consensual relationship.
And I take it the leader of the union is a significant player.
Oh, yes, I mean, of course.
Michael Weiner was beloved in this building. We loved him. And you've now got a new leader, Clark. Rick, I don't think there is a union leader in the NBA. You've got DeMora Smith.
That's right. At present, they're looking to find a new executive director.
Do you sense any shift or between Weiner and Clark in terms of your relationships with the union?
Again, I couldn't say because I don't do that.
You don't do that.
And I don't have any feeling for that.
Yeah. There's a lot of interesting sort of backstories in terms of personalities here. You mentioned before, I believe, that you've worked with what, five commissioners?
I think Tom said that.
You've worked with five commissioners.
I've worked with four.
But you've worked with Becky.
Four.
You've worked with four. And, you know, the great man has just retired.
I'm only on my second, so. Although I guess I get to count working for Paul at Covington as
you're a
pre-commissioner, so, yeah, yeah.
Do you sense there's going to be a transition in the between Stern and Silver?
Well, Adam and David worked so closely together for the last 20 years. They finished each other's sentences, and so there's at one level a continuity of approach and to our problems. At another level, the opportunity of a transition allows you to revisit all kinds of things. And Adam, I believe, has said, I know he said publicly in the last 3 weeks in a variety of forum that we're going to be looking at everything we do, and we're open to changing things and trying new ideas, and we want to innovate and get to the best place we can in our league. So I think there will be some new business practices, new rules of the game, new things that we're doing. We're looking at our age limit, we're looking at the college draft, we're looking at the way our competition is played out and new ideas for that. And so I think you're going to see some interesting new things from the NBA.
And you're going to have a transition pretty soon.
Yes. Our commissioner is retiring, I believe it's January 24th next year. And he's had a tremendous run.
Yes.
You know, the labor piece is just—it's obviously the greatest thing that's happened to our sport in recent years, having the labor piece. But we've had so many other improvements that he's responsible for. You know, the economics of the sport have improved, and the business has boomed. I mentioned MLB.com. We have our network. We have so many other business efforts. It's been quite an improvement from those tough times in the mid-90s I described.
And you've got, as a commissioner, an immortal, right? I mean, he's going to go on forever.
He's a relatively young man, so I think our ownership is quite satisfied, quite pleased with the work he's doing. So,
what's it like to work with 32 billionaires? I mean, did they ever leave loose change on the table?
Not that I've found. That might be how they got there.
It's a tough group.
It's a tough group, but it's a good group, and it's a group that I find you really can learn a lot from, because they all have different backgrounds. They have been involved in many other businesses. Some are strictly football families, the Rooneys, the Bidwells, the Maras. But some have been involved in many other businesses, and they bring that experience and that learning to bear on the football business. And it's quite refreshing, and we just finished 2 days of committee meetings, and to hear people talk about how they're marketing things in their other businesses, whether it's Bill Ford of the Ford Motor Company, whether it's Dean Spanos, whose family owns a very large construction company out in California, you know. They all bring different experience, and you really learn a lot from them.
One last question before we let everybody in the audience come in. If you project your mind 5 years out, can you guess what the biggest change in your sport's going to be, or sports in general?
Well, I think in the NBA, I would say it would relate to our international opportunities. We think that we have a game that is played in virtually every country in the world, and we believe we have an opportunity beyond the United States to grow the interest in the game of basketball and the interest in the NBA. We currently have, just as an example, we have 150 people on the ground in China in three different offices in Beijing, Shanghai, and Hong Kong. We have an office in Africa. We have several offices in Europe and in Latin America. We just opened a very small office in Russia. And that, I think in 5 years, I'm hopeful, and our business plans certainly call for a substantial increase in what we do internationally. The most difficult part of the platform, you look at sort of television sponsorship, licensed products, those are all things you can sort of do with a business staff in those areas. But events, which is the fourth leg of the stool, so to speak, that requires a fair amount of logistics and infrastructure to be able to play games in these countries. And it's challenging whether you can actually begin to replicate NBA leagues in other places, things of that nature. But those are the areas where I think we're spending a lot of our time, and we hope to see some improvements there.
Is the Russian office in the Crimea?
Fortunately, no.
Now, Tom, I was stunned this morning. It really shook me up. As a kid from Brooklyn who used to go to Ebbets Field before I became a Yankee fan, Major League Baseball, my sport, is opening in Sydney, Australia? You must be kidding.
Not kidding at all, and we're proud of it. It's a similar thing to what Rick was talking about. We're trying to spread the sport internationally. We've had, our popularity in this country has been at an all-time high in recent years. Our attendance is great, something else this commissioner has concentrated on and gotten tremendous results on. We're trying to spread that popularity overseas. We've not opened yet in Australia. We have opened in Japan three or four times. We've opened in Mexico. We've played games in Puerto Rico. I think we had one opener in Puerto Rico. Don't hold me to that. But we're trying to spread it around the world. In some places, baseball is extraordinarily popular. Obviously, Latin America, Japan, South Korea, and other places. And other places, it's not that popular, and we're trying to concentrate on spreading it to the places where, is popular and can get more popular, and not so popular, and has tremendous room for growth. So, that is another focus of our sport.
5 years, what do you see?
Well, certainly two places that we do not have a team today that we're heavily focused on, and I'd like to think that within 5 years we'll have those dealt with one way or another definitively, would be Los Angeles and London. We've been out of Los Angeles too long, and there's a lot of interest both among the civic leaders and the business community to get the NFL back to Los Angeles, and we'd like to be there.
Mm. So we're going to reverse the American Revolution.
We may, we'll see. And we also have been playing games in London for several years now. We're going to play three this year. They're very good response in the community, and I think we'll continue to explore that opportunity.
Okay. Unfortunately, time has expired, and people have 2 o'clock classes, and the boss says, it's a wrap. My thanks. Everybody should be thanking these three folks for being here.